honest, who are you? Who's Fabrizio? If we ask somebody, what would they say?
So first, thank you so much for welcoming me here. For me, it's very exciting to be actually the first of the year and first in Mika Studio.
Congratulations.
I think if I see myself as someone who tried to achieve the impossible in my world, so I try to grow as much as I can, build my business, maybe even more, and improve it every time. My biggest value at the moment is improvement and learning, encouragement, so I'm trying to be the best all the time.
So right now, what are you up to right now, these days, what do you do?
Right now, I kind of shift my little career in Australia, which before was sales and marketing, working for medium company, small company. Now here actually I'm doing video, so I'm doing
right.
YouTube, having some fun with referral marketing and evaluating business online, which is the first time for me. It's very exciting. It's a big world, so yeah, that's what I'm doing right now, actually.
And when you first came to Japan, you started, in fact, with your goal was to start a Noki enterprise.
Sort of. My father is a winemaker, so I learned to make wine with him. Then I went to Australia, start to kind of learn more about wine. And then, in a way, I learned, actually, I met a good friend of mine who was making gnocchi in Australia. He just needed help and some good buddy to make a business. So we started together, we created Gnocchi Way Australia. And at that time, I have experience with the wine and I was working with him. So we were doing really well. We actually was doing some event in Australia, you know, market, and was really going on to work. So I decided to move to Japan and have a new experience. And you know, I'm Italian, so I said, why not? Let's make also the Gnocchi Way Japan. And I came here, I started to have my own recipe with Alessandro Helps, and I started to do some market, some event. But unfortunately, it was a bit shocking, the result.
Well, I mean, yeah, a lot happened. Nobody can blame. I mean, it's still, I think, a very interesting thing that you decided to come and do gnocchi here. What's happening right now in Australia with the gnocchi?
The gnocchi, and for now, the events will be starting, finally. So the Alessandro is, maybe soon we start with the event. We got a food truck in Australia, so probably going to start again with food truck. Our idea was to buy a factory over there and produce gnocchi in Australia and maybe export around Asia. That was the idea.
Well, if you need a machine, you know who to talk
to. There we go. I know who to talk with. But yeah, for now everything stopped, so we need just to get out of time.
So one question. So your partner in Australia was the same partner in Japan or was separate?
We had the same design from Australia to Japan. The same name, because
he was also living here for a while.
He never lived here, but we kind of know each other for a while, and he knew that I was coming here in Japan, and he was interested to come one day, but then you know everything happened and everything was stopped.
Yeah, absolutely.
So let's go back a little bit. So you came from Australia to Japan, right, to start to have some adventure and also to try the gnocchi way, right? And then, so when you came here, what was the first step that you did? Like, how did you, I mean, you got with your business idea from Australia, but then how did you come here to start?
So my idea was to open a wine school in Japan. For me, it was very exciting because I like teaching, I like wine. An idea to open a wine school in Japan is not easy because, you know, it's alcohol. And then you're teaching people which don't speak English, so they speak only Japanese. So my idea when I was coming to Japan was to learn Japanese. And meantime, learn Japanese to open a business which does involve me to speak so much Japanese. And that was the gnocchi, which, you know, doing event, it doesn't really cost for too much speaking Japanese. You speak the gnocchi language. What you're cooking, that's what you're selling.
Yeah.
That's my first idea when I came to Japan.
So you wanted to be more the face of the product, not the voice.
Exactly.
So you'd have somebody then taking care of the communication.
I'm not really exactly. I was more, let's say, the producer of the gnocchi.
Yeah.
And I'll find a business partner which actually was to speak Japanese and sell gnocchi at the restaurant.
But if you, let's say you spoke Japanese, would you have done things differently? Well, if you spoke, not fluent, but if you spoke well enough.
Yes.
What would you have done differently?
Open a wine school, actually.
Directly
straight
wine
straight
school.
Away.
So in fact, the wine school was the real goal and the gnocchi was a vehicle to continue.
Going, yeah.
Okay. Actually, if you don't mind, like a step even further, what made you go, you're from Napoli originally.
Yes.
What made you go to Australia?
Well, I was an accountant. For 23 and a half, I decided to go to Australia because, you know, accounting is not really exciting for me. Mm-hmm. So I said,
why did you become an accountant in the first place? Your
parents?
My
brother
or?
Is an accountant.
Family.
So
okay.
There we go, family business and
older brother, younger
older
brother.
Brother.
Okay, of course.
The youngest. So I decided to move everything. I moved with really nothing to Australia, like with 1,000 euro in my pocket, one way ticket with no English, and just moved to Australia.
Did your parents say, or your family?
And they said you're crazy. And, they actually bet money that I will come back after 1 year.
So
they
bet money. So I want to bet you come back.
Sorry. But yeah, how about your English? That's a good question.
So no speaking English, you go to Australia?
Yeah, to Australia, yeah.
Wow.
Because, you know, yeah, you don't really learn so much
language.
So, yeah, went there without nothing and there you go.
Wow.
It was adventure, it was a good adventure, absolutely.
So the first step, you learned English? And
the first step was, to survive because I had no money. So I had to find any kind of job.
Okay.
I'm Italian, so I sold myself as a pizza chef, which I was not.
To an Italian place?
To an Italian place.
So you could speak Italian with them? Okay.
The guy liked me and said, you know what, even if you don't make pizza, it's fine, you're good. You're a good worker, you're a hard worker. So I started to learn Italian, English, and started to grow. I started to work in the farm, because in Australia, you know, if you're working on a visa, if you work in the farm...
So you have to extend it, right?
Extend, and then I started to work in sales, and then my career...
But at the point you did sales, you already spoke English.
It was really pretty English when I started working sales.
Okay, but I mean, it's pretty impressive because if in Australia you want to have your second year, you have to do within the first year the farm work. So that means you had less than 9 months of English experience at that time.
No, at the time, the first year I did only farming, just for farm, because for study English.
So at the farm you also learned some English?
Yes,
so
because we're, let's say, people around the world to share, you know, working together, so it's just speaking English all the time.
I mean, it's very impressive that your English... I mean, at this point, your English is fantastic. So, but I mean, it makes sense. And if you think, okay, if you look at it in the way I learned English by going to the country, I'll do the same with Japanese. Was that part of the reasoning?
That's exactly. That was very tricky because I said, okay, you know what? I learned English by studying, by talking.
Mm-hmm.
And I always think the same. When I came to Japan, I can do the same.
Mm-hmm.
But
yeah.
Here it's different. It's very different because... If you can't put people in the street and talk straight away, you know. In Australia, you can go on the train, people just stop you, where are you from? What do you do here, you know? And Japan is quite hard to have a conversation every day. So it's quite hard to practice. Even if you study, it's hard to practice. And then you have this bubble of foreign that you hang out all the time.
Yeah, you get comfortable
really
with the foreigners, right?
It's really hard to, let's say, to stick and learn Japan.
So the biggest problem was not being able to use it every day.
Yeah.
Okay, and then the gnocchi way was born now in Japan, and it was around for how long?
Gnocchi way born at let's say October 2019.
Mm-hmm.
I stayed around for 7-8 months
mm-hmm.
before the coronavirus. Actually, just straight away in the coronavirus, all the events stopped, so we had to stop everything.
So the main reason was because the gnocchi way was mostly based on events, right?
Yes.
Okay.
We actually were starting also to make sample for restaurant,
mm-hmm.
to provide to restaurant, because the idea was once you have the product, once having gnocchi, and you sell to the restaurant, you kind of building a trust between you and them. So next time I can come back, I can sell the wine, because that was the idea. It was sell the wine, go in the wine business, and once you sell the gnocchi, sell the wine, and then you start also importing more stuff from Italy and Europe. And then you start, you know, to help to the restaurant.
But in Australia, do Australians generally know what gnocchi is?
Australia love gnocchi. Like
so they know the product.
Because we are very few people in Australia who are making gnocchi. And Australia, when I see us, oh my god, two Italian, I love gnocchi. Remember my grandma was making gnocchi for me. I buy it straight away, you know.
Yeah.
They were spending maybe $15 per plate.
Wow.
Which in Japan, unfortunately, I can't charge them. Because people don't know gnocchi what it is.
See, that's the question, right? So, what were you aware of this before you started in Japan?
I did my research, but not well enough. Because I thought, you know, gnocchi, it's something new. It can kind of educate people to know more gnocchi. But educate people in Japan takes time.
Mm-hmm.
Takes
yeah.
marketing strategy. Takes a lot of things.
Yeah, marketing is a whole ordeal of its own, right? It's a whole challenge of its own.
So I jumped because the idea was to open first a shop, because I met a guy for friends from Italy here in Japan, and we met and we said we like each other, let's open a shop with the daily shop with the gnocchi and the wine and stuff.
Kind of a Dean and DeLuca style
exactly.
approach, right?
Then we see the price, it was really expensive.
just to have that.
Just to have the place, the machine, you know, the meat, it's very expensive. So you know what, let's now open, instead to open the shop, let's see how the market react to our product. So let's first open a tent, a market event.
Yeah.
Let's see what people think about gnocchi. And then we start with the
event. What was the first impression?
People just stop and say, what's this?
They don't know what gnocchi is.
How
did you explain it to Japanese?
We explained like a potato pasta. It was really simple to explain. It's a
pasta made by potato.
That's it.
Yeah.
And for them, was really hard because the recipe in Australia, it give us a texture which is really soft.
And Japanese people like hard?
Japanese like hard because supermarket here sell hard gnocchi. So
they sell gnocchi in the supermarket?
Yes.
But now you're talking about people who know gnocchi.
Yes.
So what about the people? Most of them don't know gnocchi.
Most of them don't know gnocchi, but...
So what did they think? What did they think of trying it?
They all the time think about mochi mochi. You know,
so they thought it was like a mochi.
Exactly. So they kind of associate that with the gnocchi. It was hard to kind of...
And to add tomato to that would be difficult, right?
It would make it even more...
Yeah, but I mean, if you're in Japan, I think nobody would ever consider putting tomato paste on a piece of mochi. So I think for them it's like, boom,
yeah.
I have a few customers who say, oh, gnocchi, I love gnocchi.
Right.
And they say, gnocchi is so good. They're the best gnocchi I've ever.
But they know real gnocchi.
Because the from in Japan, the gnocchi are overwhelmed of flour.
Yeah.
When you put too much
starchy,
flour.
Starchy, very starchy.
Exactly. It's
yeah.
really hard to chew. It's not enjoyable. It's heavy.
Yeah, I don't like them here personally.
People love it.
Sadly, I didn't get the chance to try Fabrizio's gnocchi. I would have loved to. But you also did a sauce, right? You did the pasta sauce.
We also mostly make the sauce. The recipe come from, let's say, our business partner in Australia, and some recipe come from my other business partner in Japan.
And how did that, as a sauce, how did people like it?
Went well. We tried to do some fusion between, let's say, mentai and gnocchi, but people didn't really go with it.
I mean, apart from the gnocchi, what happened with the sauce? Did people like the sauce?
People like the sauce. The best sauce was the Genovese sauce.
Genovese, so basil, pesto.
Yeah.
Did you at some point try to promote more the sauce, or did you really want to push the gnocchi?
I thought about it. I thought to produce sauce and supply to, let's say, to restaurants.
Yeah.
But again, I'm thinking about myself, I'm not a chef. I don't want to become one.
You didn't want to be a chef?
I don't want to become a chef.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't it be sales?
That should be sales, exactly. So I might need someone to hire and then I'll be in the sales industry.
Yeah.
But that's for me, it's fine. The problem is just the language.
So again, you come to the issue of
language.
Okay. But we've heard from people with experience in the language, who speak the language perfectly even, that they had trouble being accepted as someone doing business. I mean, what was it? They had an issue where even though they spoke Japanese fluently, They didn't have any luck because apparently they were the foreigner role and they needed still the Japanese second person. Even though they were doing sales, they still needed a Japanese person.
Well,
did you have a Japanese person with you or?
I had my wife, but you know my wife and the other person was my business partner was Italian. He was really good speaking Japanese.
Really?
Really good speaking Japanese, but unfortunately, as you see, for India, it's hard to trust for them.
Right.
It's really hard to penetrate the market because even that, they always choose a store which is a Japanese base or a Japanese owner. It's hard for you to choose a for India because they don't understand the language, they know the rules, so all the time they need to explain me what's happening.
So it's fear. It's
fear, it's a bit of, you know, I want to avoid trouble, so you know, it's better to don't call you anymore.
Yeah,
so
a Japanese person will understand my problems better, so
yes,
I want
exactly.
to work. Yeah, I understand that. That must be very frustrating, of course, especially when you want to be accepted as at least as or seen as a business person. But
so then it was already working in 2019, right? How it started 2020 for Nenyaku?
Start well. We won a small competition to have a event in Panstock, which one of the biggest bakery in
Nishinaka, right?
They invite us to go there once a month for free to use their space. And the 2020 was going well because we make this good event. So
that's the beginning of 2020, right?
Yeah, we bring the wine as well, you know, and customers actually, they come, they know the brand, so they're willing to try the gnocchi as well. And then this customer was just, let's say, pay a bit more compared to the market.
Yeah.
So for us it was great. We were growing. Our Instagram was starting booming because they have a huge followers on Instagram. They start to tag us.
Yeah, Painstock has a good following, I think, and they have they're very popular. It's a great space to be.
Yeah.
But so at which point did you pivot? At which point did you say, you know, the Noki way is not my way for now? I want to try something else. When did that happen?
Let's say with the cancellation of three big events we had.
When? About?
March.
March. This is before the lockdown then?
It was before the lockdown, but it was just on the time then all the event was cancelled.
Okay.
The time is called Sakura time, you know. We have three big events, one in Toshima, one in the city, one in the airport.
Mm-hmm.
And say, okay, you know what? I think it's going to take so much time. Summer is coming and selling gnocchi in summer is really hard because it's a hot, hot dish. It's time to just build off everything and let's start an adventure.
Take a step back,
yeah.
Try something else.
Yeah, that's really important.
So what's the new adventure?
So the things with YouTube for me was not something really serious in the beginning.
On YouTube?
On YouTube, because the growth was really slow.
And what is it on YouTube?
Let's say I'm helping people to solve daily problem in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm giving them a guideline to really fix huge
foreigners,
problems in Japan for foreigners.
So how foreigners can...
But
improve their daily life.
So one question, that started while the gnocchi way was open?
It started.
Long before.
Oh,
okay.
Me, it was a hobby.
So when did that start?
I just helped people to, you know, to really solve daily problems, like open up an account, get a SIM card, or get a credit card, or get a job.
So what made you say, I want to help people? Because that must mean that you had a frustration yourself. Something
yeah.
must have been difficult before you said, oh, let me stop other people from having the same problem.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
What was your frustration?
Because first I grew up in a way that I done everything by myself. I was in Australia. I know how hard it is for start by yourself. I know
yeah.
that's really struggle sometimes to have no help. So that's why I also studied to be a life coach. And from the time I really have the passion to help others. And when I was in Japan again, my wife had asked me a lot, but you want to be
independent.
You want to be dependent on your wife all the time.
Yeah.
So I always try to find a way all the time to fix problems and do stuff. And I solve it and say, you know what, let's share it with others. I know there are so many foreigners like me, they struggle.
Yeah.
I want to help them.
Most
even
course.
For free, because in the end, it's just information from them. So.
Yeah.
And that started 2000.
Actually, that started just right away. I came to Japan after 3-4 months.
Oh,
so it was let's say
2019
in May.
Yeah.
May, June. Yeah.
And it's funny because I think it's called the Japanese way.
The Japanese ways, yeah.
So you have the gnocchi ways, and then
the
you
Japanese
have the Japanese
ways.
Ways.
Yes.
Yes. And so when those events were cancelled, you said, okay, let's wait with gnocchi, let's put it aside, let's focus now on what was a hobby. Did it already show a profit, a turnover at that point?
Because, you know, at the time, you kind of put your number down, it's like, okay, I can't do gnocchi, I can't do my job, which is sales and marketing.
You
I
couldn't
do
Japanese
stuff.
Lessons either, because all the lessons were cancelled.
Exactly. So I have to do something. So, you know, let's do YouTube. It's something that's more really private, creation, you don't need to learn Japanese for that. And then I met a good guy who was a YouTuber like me. And we grew together, we went explore all around Japan, we're filming. And now the business is growing, not to business, I can't call business, for me it's just a passion for now. It's growing, I'm giving still tips to everyone to survive and be successful in Japan. And I'm making online courses also for them.
Mm-hmm.
So these days I'm more let's say creating online courses for people who need help in Japan.
So the courses are mostly for foreigners trying to make a business in Japan or starting their life in Japan?
Not necessarily business, anybody coming to Japan,
yeah,
right?
Anything. I mean, I used to divide the courses in different aspects of life. When you actually, you come to Japan, you are lost. There are so many things to do, what
mm.
have to do. So my online courses is designed to help you from the beginning of your venture in Japan to become the master of Japanese life. In this case, I'm teaching really how to open a bank account, how to get a credit card, how to get a SIM card, very simple stuff. Then I keep straight away, with the medium content, which is like how to get a job in Japan, how to
yeah.
get, let's say, your little online business, how to sell your stuff online. And then I'm going, let's say, to the kind of big package, which is how to do business in Japan. What's the biggest struggle? why it's hard to communicate with Japanese. Do you need Japanese to make business in Japan? So it's a very big course that I'm putting my passion, my time to try to help as many people possible.
And so, for example, from these courses, what is the idea? So the idea is going to be supported by the YouTube channel, or is going to go through a different platform? Or?
Yeah, so the idea, again, it's to sponsor from my YouTube channel, and also to grab thanks to you guys also about the website. I'm building a website, and I think you guys are expert about that. So I'm going to also build my website, my blogging, so in the same little meter sources to promote my courses.
One question. So if you, let's say, if it's kind of, this question is going to be kind of difficult because I think nobody thought what was going to happen in 2020, right? And most of the business has been a challenge, right? Or they have mutated completely when they were originally. But what would you do a little bit different? I'm not saying if you knew about it, so would you start making iterations and try the gnocchi way faster earlier?
My big mistake when I came to Japan was to follow too much my heart and not be more logical. Because what I would like to do different is study Japanese.
Mm-hmm.
If I could study Japanese and focus only on that every day and maybe just a little bit business aside, after 2 years I could be able to speak Japanese. Here in Japan is a big thing, especially in Fukuoka.
Mm-hmm.
We have more connection, even from my YouTube channel. Or we maybe speak in Japanese maybe sometimes. We have more YouTubers from Japan as well.
But so you would have wanted to speak Japanese then?
Earlier.
That's
also
my thing.
But so okay, assuming you, so let's take it to like a hypothetical now. So imagine you speak Japanese again. Imagine Corona never happened.
Mm-hmm.
What would you have done? You would have gone to the wine school. So
yes, the idea was to open a wine school.
So knowing what you know now, imagine Corona doesn't happen, right?
Okay.
You know Japanese. What would you have done to make that happen, the wine school? What would have been your next step? Because you speak Japanese.
Yes, okay.
So what would you have done?
So next step was to rent a place and to have no wine bar, but a wine school.
So a permanent place, not a pop-up, not temporary. You would find a location, rent a location.
Rent a location, open a wine school. And training staff, because in Japan I think most of Baito staff who work in the restaurant, they don't know how to explain wine, even big hotel as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I really want to have this kind of, because for me when you drink wine, it's something that you don't drink every day, okay? Most of people drink every day wine. So you want to experience about it. You want to experience, see where the wine comes from, what it tastes like, okay, what's the winemaker did. So I want to teach staff in Japan how to transmit the emotion to the customers.
And also how to select a wine.
How to select, you could go to a wine bar, it's a big list of wine, you don't know where to start.
But so who's the target in that case? So you would train staff, meaning you again would now become then the face of the brand, and you would put in Japanese staff to deal with the customer.
The idea for me was, let's say, a little fun with B2C customers, because
mm-hmm.
at least I like to have a B2C fun with customers to just appreciate your wine, and then again B2B experience with all the staff can teach more about wine. And then
when you say B2B, you mean like the people
hotel,
you mentioned before, so hotel, servers, all these things.
And then to bring my own label, to create my own label from Italy,
mm-hmm. yeah.
to my own story of wine, import here in Japan, and let's say distribute or from your hotel or restaurant.
But now you're making online classes, right? What stops you from trying to make an online package for wine?
Well, that's the thing, because I have to check about priority first. And I
right.
think right now, it's what people really want, it's to survive, to make money.
Yeah.
Wine is still something you can enjoy, not really important thing.
I think wine consumption went up during Corona, though, if I'm not crazy.
I think I saw something about the numbers, and yeah, the numbers go up.
Because people stay home, they drink more.
That's true.
They need to forget.
Yeah. People start cooking, but no, people start doing more like these improvement things, right? I want to learn how to cook.
Oh, yeah.
I need a red wine for this food. What's a good red wine? I don't know. Let's
That's
find
why my
out.
Next mission, as you mentioned, is the wine industry. I want to come back there.
Right. Because now, I mean, full disclosure, you are now planning to leave Japan. You're taking a new adventure in your life. But that said, you have a community and a connection here in Japan. Would you in the future look at trying to build still content for Japan once you're outside?
Yes.
So, for example, this wine course, and then
yes.
ask people here to sell it here, I suppose.
Yes, I mean, that's the idea as well. Because, again, my wife is Japanese, fortunately. And
you'll be visiting a lot because
she's from Fukuoka,
right?
I still want to learn Japanese because, again, I miss the things to learn a new language.
And the food.
So I will come back and hopefully I will bring more ideas.
So you want to come
market.
Back with the wine? And
yes. Yeah.
So now just quickly wrap up. Now, knowing that Corona would happen, imagine you knew it would happen and you speak Japanese. What would you have done in Japan?
Go online straight away.
So for the wine courses as well?
For the wine course, yes, everything.
Mm-hmm.
And so coronavirus came.
How would you reach people in that situation? How would you, because nobody, what would be your mode of marketing, you think?
With the wine industry?
Yeah, so let's say you can't do events, right? There's the same Noki problem. How do you think you would try reaching Japanese people wanting to learn more about wine? What would you do?
That's a good idea. Well, I will actually make the content first in Japanese.
Of course.
And
create the content.
The idea is again to hire people to help me, a team of let's
okay.
say a blogger who creates ads for me, because in the end, again,
sales. You're looking for sales people.
Sales, but online sales.
Right.
Because we
digital sales.
Digital
people.
Sales. Yes,
okay.
Which right now I'm learning by myself.
But so the step would be again the same, right? So even if there was no corona, step would be it's just the method of reaching the people changes, right?
Exactly.
The vehicle changes, but the goal is still the same.
Exactly.
Find Japanese sales staff. Have your content, you not be the main representative or communicating person, but have people. So you would have that would be still the way you.
That would be
still
the way, yes, exactly.
And that's still something you would like to do in the future.
Yes. If I speak Japanese fluently.
Well, I mean.
Fluently in a way, it's like people can understand me
yeah.
for sure.
Would there be a way of training the staff without speaking Japanese fluently?
I like to be very clear,
mm-hmm.
and I really would like to people understand me. When I train them in sales, because in the end I pay them, in the end it's something that
mm-hmm.
I want them to invest in them.
Yeah.
I was thinking, you know, maybe my wife can help with that, but
as an interpreter, translator.
Again,
then.
I heard so many people, why don't hire a translator? Why don't hire someone help you to translate?
Money, first of all.
Again, in sales, the most important part, it's the tonality,
feeling, right?
The feeling, the word is 7%. So it's like you pay someone 100%, but you get only 7%. From that job that you
think. Yes, but no, because no offense, but at the same time you're trusting, the reason you're hiring a Japanese person is because you trust in their feeling, their sense of how to communicate to the end consumer, right?
Yeah.
In a way, I mean, so at the same time, what would stop you from purely bringing over the content and then letting them, because I mean, you need to trust them for the sales. So
it's the ego, it's the passion. Because I love
you want to do it yourself.
I want to do it myself.
But you know you can't. Or
exactly.
Stop.
I want to see objection. I want to understand why it's not. I want to do everything.
Right. I mean, it seems like some of the people we talked to who made successful agreements with places, even though they spoke very fluent Japanese, what they did is they had a Japanese person go with them and they sat together. And what I think the person was able to do was to still read the body language and give their interpretation of, oh, this Japanese person seems like he has an objection about this, and then run it through the via.
That's interesting.
So I think like this kind of double teaming, like good cop, bad cop situation.
It was funny because to somebody that we talked, is like he's fluent Japanese, but he couldn't have the same impact by him talking directly than having somebody local to
yeah.
tell the same thing, but to the people, no, it's a different way of, and even he was selecting, right, for older people,
yeah,
some older guys, for if the customer was a lady. Also.
I mean, you can read, you people can hear about this in our previous conversation. I think we did a whole talk with Carlos Guzman. I mean, let's mention it. And so, the talk was basically how the questions that the customer asked were very different. So if he would sit alone with the customer, I think, in just to quickly condense it, they would ask, where are you from, how old are you, and they would basically find out there is no relevant, there's no no shared connection.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's where it ended, while the person that he selected for that job had a shared background or shared link or connection, and that's what started that trust, like you said in the beginning. I think that was the main keyword, actually. It was about showing trust, showing stability, and I think that seems to be like a way to go in Japan, disregarding your own ego, disregarding your own level of language in Japanese.
Been working in a skincare company for 3 years, and we were doing a recommission job.
In Australia,
which was for me very exciting. And I was working in the airport, or was in the city, in the shopping center. And we had a huge amount of diversity customers. And we had, you know, Chinese, Australian, Thai people, and...
What about the Japanese
people? So impressive. The Japanese people was the hardest one to convince. The hardest one. Even, you know, Japanese people love skincare.
Yeah.
And the product that we had is natural, you know, it's Australia made. We were doing really good sales, but Japanese was the hardest one.
What was usually the argument that tipped the scale?
It's because we understand how they behave. Because the things like, we say something, they say yes. Yes, yes. And then we think they got to buy something.
They're agreeing, but there's actually
but
an objection,
end,
right?
For them it's polite to say yes and don't to say no. We can't understand it.
Yeah.
So with the time, I kind of start to learn.
Identify their objections.
Exactly,
right?
I need time, a lot of time.
Mm-hmm. What did you learn? What was the main, like some of the ones you still remember? What was a way of dealing with the yes objection?
Let's say it's more... about it's a body language that you learn to read. Okay.
Body language.
Because in the end, you can see when someone say yes to you, but they don't listen.
Yeah.
You can learn that. Okay. And you can spot a lie as well. That's what you do with NLP. When you spot a lie,
mm-hmm.
and most of the Japanese don't want to buy from you. They just stay there because you know they will be pride to you to listen to you or something.
Yeah.
Like that.
Their airplane is still a long time away, so they have time.
Exactly. The only things that I learned. When I close the 90% of sales in Japanese, it's that when they ask a question, if they ask a question, how much it costs, or is that natural, or they start to touch the product, that means they're interested.
How did you tease a question out of them?
Well, the question to them, or they just...
So, how did you make them ask you the questions?
The first thing, yeah, okay, there was a nice guy near to me to work all the time. This guy was trying to sell to Asian people because he loved Chinese. He was like, Chinese buy so much, I sell to Chinese. But he couldn't understand the difference between Chinese and Japanese. So he stopped all the time Asian, and this guy was just yelling because, you know, Chinese you can yell.
Yeah.
Hey, buy this one. And he sometimes stops from Japanese, he did the same.
And they just get scared.
The Japanese get scared.
Yeah.
So the trick that I learned with Japanese is that really you need some mirror matching. Don't scream, same voice, calm, don't push. Be patient. It's hard to build a trust, but again, go with the time.
But how did you catch them? So you have a Japanese person going by. How would
so
you get their attention?
So we have these people go up and down. So we have, let's say, this top one product, which was the Manuka honey. It was a
sounds good.
Cream that you put on the skin, you rub, and then you remove the dead skin. So you remove the dirt and stuff. And you know, we stop people by give a free sample. In the end, the free sample is just put the cream on the pores. And then we start to remove. They start to see, oh my God, this is dirty. And then we start to sell speech. That's how we stop people. And then we start to, you know.
But then your pitch was very different with the Japanese people.
The company trained us to have the same speech for everyone.
Yeah.
But you learned how to make it.
Interesting.
Because again, our speech was like, can you imagine this on your face 10 times more? People say, oh, 10 times more? What are you talking about? My face 10 times more? And people take the mirror and show the face, you know? Which is really aggressive.
Yeah, it's
for Australian, Chinese, it works. But for Japanese, if you just really put the mirror on the face,
they run
like,
away.
You're done. You're done.
I don't want to see myself.
So
don't use our bathroom. But
so yeah, that's what we learn. With my experience in...
I mean, that sounds like a very teachable thing as well. Even, you could even teach that to Japanese staff, in a way.
Probably, actually, that might be already his...
first lesson. Free sample lesson.
The business lesson.
Yeah, we included most of many tips about really how to sell the Japanese.
Yeah, very interesting.
Very, very useful.
Yeah.
Interesting. So, from now, what is your plans for the future? What are you thinking for the future? Where are you... seeing yourself?
for now I want to, let's say I want to keep improving my sales technique, because that I love to do. I want to build my first online business, which again is the Japanese way, but I wanted to be able to, let's say, to have a team who can manage this business in the future, and I want to build more business around. And the next will be the wine business. It can be import-export business, depending on what's the market request, you know. So very new there, so we'll see what's
right. Next step, Malta.
Next step, Malta, 3rd of January.
Sounds nice.
I'm going to miss Japan very much, but it's
we'll miss you too.
The new fresh beginning, so and it's a must.
It's interesting, you're an explorer, to be honest. You're
yeah, like
a pioneer, so it's interesting. And it's you're like you get some knowledge from Italy, bring it to Australia. You arrive to Australia, get more tools in your backpack, then come to Japan. Okay? Put more tools in your backpack, now go to Malta, right? And then so it's interesting. Mm-hmm. It's interesting.
And we know you. I mean, I personally think it's a very honorable. I mean, it's admirable that you pivoted or you changed from Nokia away to something else when you felt that was the right move. Because we know you're a dedicated person. You're here you're working here on your projects now every morning since 8 a.m. You're here. Our camera tells us that you're here, so we know. So it's not a question of dedication. It's a question of not being afraid. It's also actually putting aside your ego. So before you said you have ego, but at the same time you're able to say at least to yourself, like, hey, this isn't working, or I want to do this. And
YouTube,
I think that's very admirable.
The hardest things in my life, because you expose yourself online.
That's true.
Yeah.
You expose yourself to your family, because
for everybody,
the YouTube channel, your family start to that. You know?
But do you expose it? That's another thing. Do you really expose yourself? Because your behavior, we talked about this quickly as well in private as well, like our behavior with our family or when we are in our hometown, we're very different from the way we are here. So is it really exposing yourself, or is it, because the you are to them is a different you who you are to us.
The problem is what really worried to us to be judged for people.
Right.
Because let's say I made a video about
especially family.
I lose a lot of body fat fast in Japan.
Yeah.
And then there I take off my shirt, okay?
Yeah.
And my family, my friends say, oh my God, what are you doing? You expose yourself. Okay.
Yeah.
It sounds stupid, but actually remove some part of your clothes and shoot the camera.
Let's not do that right now, but
it's exactly no. But it's really, 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 really hard.
Mm-hmm. And as the views start growing, of course you will have a lot of positive, a lot of likes, but also there's a big possibility you will have dislikes, right? So
and
most of them goes a lot,
like,
right?
Yeah.
And human beings, we always will focus on the negative.
But that's good. I mean,
is it?
Feedback is good. Good feedback, of course,
right.
Is good.
But
even better. That's the problem.
But how do you distinguish which is actual, which is not trolling, and what is actual feedback? What is good for you to read and not?
So I got some really bad feedback last time about my English.
Okay.
I said, you with Indian accent, stuff like that.
Right.
Blonde with Indian accent. It was painful, because come on guys, I spent 10 hours for this video. It's for you, it's for helping you.
Right.
Okay. But you understand, it's like, okay, you know, it's my accent. I have to learn English, I have to improve
right.
it.
I mean, on the other side, isn't it just kind of sad for the person? A person that you don't know spent energy and time watching your video, listened to you, and then took time to write a comment of how unaccepting he or she is, or how intolerant he or she is. What does this say
really
about the person?
Yeah, not really on what
not
the
content, nothing.
But that's what I'm saying. No? Like, the more views you have,
the more
haters you might
but
have.
But so this is the kind of stuff you don't even have to pay attention to.
Well,
or at least just kind of feel sorry for them in a way.
In the end, you say, okay, it's good, because you send me a message on my YouTube, so the algorithm will pick up, because more people interacting to your video, and
yeah.
you guys pick up. So
plus they watched it. Even somebody who didn't like it
exactly.
or didn't
they
like
watch.
You watched it.
Exactly. So in the end, it's, you know, it's everyone's going to achieve in the end. You just need to really spend.
Well, not everybody, I hope, but
not everyone, sorry. part of your community is going to achieve.
Right.
And you have to step up for
yeah.
that.
But you can't be loved by everyone.
Yeah.
But that is good. You know,
yeah.
That's the best thing.
I mean, to be honest, if you're pleasing too many people, you're doing something wrong as well. there's usually, because people need to get out of their comfort zone, or you need to expose people to new things, and many people don't like new things. So if you're only getting good feedback, it probably means you're not doing anything special or nothing interesting.
But I got people on my Instagram that contact me, because, you know, it's same name, Instagram and YouTube. They contact me and say, please help me with the Uber Eats account, join. And I'm there, I'm not charging anything. They're spending 10, 20 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, me and Tino, we try to find some problem on the internet. We try to find...
Who's Tino, real quick?
Tino Pesenti is my friend for YouTube as well.
So you're doing it together with him?
Together sometimes.
Okay.
And we try to find a problem, and we try to contact the, you know, the let's say the creator of the video, but they don't reply the message.
It's a numbers game.
Easier, exactly, or something like that. But again, I'm there.
Or they have
them
too much
time.
Ego.
So I have so many people actually really text me all the time to help them with the process, with the video. So that's what really make you feel good. So again, I want to keep going because I'm helping people.
Mm-hmm.
I'm something good for my life and positive life.
Mm-hmm.
So let's keep going.
Yeah. Yeah, but just keep doing that, right? And the same when you get to Malta, just keep putting in kindness, seeing how you can help people. And
I think for sure something that we will try to work with and through income also is to try to promote this, because I'm sure many people doesn't know many videos that are super useful, like how to get your Rakuten credit card, no? Or there might be people that might be doing deliveries. There's many tips there that are super interesting. People doesn't know.
There's also a video about how to register business for free, so you know, you didn't spend any money for registering business, and people found...
I wish I knew that one.
Or also how to sell things online.
As things online.
But in real life, so I think this is something that probably...
Practical information, yeah.
Probably that also as a community we should, you know, help people to know these tools exist.
Yes,
you know?
Absolutely.
So,
yeah, we will do, well, I mean, I'd be happy to share whatever you're posting, whatever you're doing. We wish you the best of luck in Malta, to say the least. We know you'll do great, and hopefully the whole environment will become a more hospitable environment. So hopefully step by step, but the only way to move forward is by doing it day by day. Learn from what you did, what you would have done differently in Japan, which is probably do a bit more market research, what the people on the spot think. But then again, you might do something online and focus on here. So we look forward to hearing about what you're going to do.
Thank you for shooting in touch.
Absolutely. We'll see you wherever
you're
here.
Where people can find you?
People can find me on Instagram, The Japanese Ways. And soon the website will go the same name.
The Japanese
Way.
Ways. Singular.
Yes.
S. Plural. Ways.
.com and YouTube channel, Twitter, same name.
We'll put the links. We'll put the links in the video. People will know how to find you. We'll even refer to the moment you take off your shirt. I think that's an important one. And I think that's probably the one that got you the most likes, right?
Yeah, because you need courage to do it.
That's true, though.
You need to push up and do some, burpee all the time.
You don't breathe for 20 minutes during the video. New record has been... it's also a Guinness World Record. Longest holding a video. Interesting. Cool. We look forward to seeing it. We look forward to sharing it. Thank you for your time.
I appreciate your time. Thank you so much for inviting me. It's a very beautiful studio. So
yeah. I mean, hopefully people recognize it in one of your videos too. So yeah, we're very proud of it, and we hope to put it to good use. We're thankful for you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
All right.
All the best.
Thank
for the next.
Thank you,
David.